In this lesson, we will discuss an example of how to apply the method of repeating variables to determine pi groups in dimensional analysis problems. Let's say that you work for a company that makes large rectangular signs, and your boss wants you to develop an expression that will predict the maximum drag force caused by wind blowing on the sign. This occurs when the wind is blowing at a 90-degree angle to the surface of the sign. For simplicity, we will assume the sign is rigid and its thickness T is very small compared to its height H and width W. We start by determining the variables that should impact the value of the drag force significantly. In addition to the dimensions of the sign, we also might consider the wind speed V, properties of air such as density rho and absolute viscosity mu, and the absolute roughness of the sign, which we'll call epsilon. From our everyday experience, we can deduce which of these variables impact the drag force significantly. For example, as the wind speed V increases, the drag force will increase as well. And you can test this out qualitatively by sticking your hand out of a window while driving at low speeds and driving at high speeds, and noticing that it takes much more effort to keep your hand stationary at higher speeds. Additionally, as the sign's profile area, that's the area perpendicular to the flow, gets larger, the drag force should increase too. Since the profile area is the height h times the width w, both h and w will be important variables. Fluid density rho is important because higher density fluids have more mass and therefore more momentum for the same flow speed, which means it takes more force to keep the sign in place as the flow is redirected around the sign. Absolute viscosity mu is important because it requires more effort to deform higher viscosity fluids. For example, it takes more effort to move your hand through honey, which has a high viscosity, compared to water, which has a low viscosity. The only variables which might not be important are the thickness T and the surface roughness epsilon. This is where you need to have good insight into the behavior of fluids as they flow around blunt objects like the sign in this example. If we look at the side view of the sign and we're able to visualize the flow under typical conditions, we would see that the incoming flow is redirected around the sign and the flow separates from the sign at its edge. Behind the sign, the flow is swirling and turbulent. This separated flow causes a significant pressure drop, with the pressure lower behind the sign compared to in front of the sign. It's this pressure difference that's responsible for almost all of the drag force experienced by the sign. There will be some frictional resistance at the edge of the sign, and that frictional resistance increases as the thickness T grows. But if the sign is very thin compared to its profile area, that is, if T is much smaller than W or H, the frictional resistance at the edge of the sign will be very small compared to the drag force caused by the separated flow. So we can assume the thickness T likely will have a very small impact on the drag force, and we can omit it from the analysis. Similarly, while roughening a surface can increase the amount of frictional resistance, its contribution to the total drag forces likely will be small compared to the contribution from the separated flow. So, the surface roughness epsilon can be omitted from the analysis as well. We now write the functional relationship between all of the relevant variables. The drag force Fd is some unknown function of the sign's width, the sign's height, the density and absolute viscosity of the fluid, and the flow speed. The total number of variables in this problem, n, is 6. We now can determine a set of pi groups to study this problem experimentally. We list the basic dimensions of all 6 variables in the FLT and MLT dimensional systems. The drag force has dimensions of force in the FLT system and dimensions of mass, length, per time squared in the MLT system. The dimensions of W and H are length in both the FLT and MLT systems. In a previous video, we discussed the dimensions of the fluid density rho and absolute viscosity mu. Density has dimensions of force, length to the negative 4, times squared in the FLT system, and dimensions of mass per length cubed in the MLT system. Absolute viscosity has dimensions of force, length to the negative 2, time in the FLT system, and dimensions of mass, length to the negative 1, time to the negative 1 in the MLT system. And finally, the flow speed V has dimensions of length per time in both the FLT and MLT systems. Now notice that we need force, length, and time to completely describe the dimensions of the six variables in the FLT system, and that we need mass, length, and time to completely describe the dimensions of the six variables in the MLT system. Since the number of basic dimensions in both systems is the same, it's 3, the number of reference dimensions, k, is 3 as well. The Buckingham Pi theorem states that the number of pi groups that we'll need to study this problem experimentally is the number of variables n minus the number of reference dimensions, k, which is 6 minus 3, which means that we'll need 3 pi groups. Next, we select our repeating variables from among the 5 independent variables, and we'll need 3 repeating variables since k is 3. We list the independent variables and their dimensions in the MLT system. We also could do this step in the FLT system if we wished. There are a few combinations of these variables that would make a valid set of repeating variables. We just have to ensure that all of the basic dimensions are included in the set of variables and that you cannot make a dimensionless group from those variables. For example, width w, density rho, and speed v are a valid set of repeating variables because the dimensions mass, length, and time are present in at least one of the variables, and you cannot make a dimensionless quantity from those variables. There are other valid sets of repeating variables as well, such as w, mu, and v. One example of a set of variables that cannot be used as the repeating variables is w, h, and rho. And there are two reasons for this. First, it's possible to make a dimensionless group from these variables, w over h. Second, notice that the dimension of time does not appear in w, h, or rho. Now we will create the pi 1 group, which includes the dependent variable fd. Pi 1 is equal to fd times w to the a, v to the b, rho to the c. We plug in the dimensions for all 4 variables, and we want to find the values of exponents a, b, and c that will make this product dimensionless. We distribute the exponents through each term and combine all the terms with base m, combine all the terms with base l, and combine all the terms with base t. We now have mass raised to the power of 1 plus c, length raised to the power of 1 plus a plus b minus 3c, and time raised to the power of negative 2 minus b. In order for this equation to be true, the exponents of mass, length, and time on the left side of the equation must equal the exponents of mass, length, and time on the right side of the equation. We equate the exponents on both sides of the equation and develop 3 equations with 3 unknowns. 1 plus c equals 0, 1 plus a plus b minus 3c equals 0, and negative 2 minus b equals 0. Solving the 3 equations gives us a equals negative 2, b equals negative 2, and c equals negative 1. Applying these exponents to our pi 1 group, pi 1 is fd over w squared v squared rho. Now let's find the 2 remaining pi groups using the 2 remaining non-repeating independent variables, which are h and mu. Pi 2 is equal to h times w to the a, v to the b, rho to the c. We plug in the MLT dimensions of all 4 variables, distribute the exponents through each term, and combine all the terms with base m, combine all the terms with base l, and combine all the terms with base t. We have mass raised to the power of c, length raised to the power of 1 plus a plus b minus 3c, and time raised to the power of negative b. We equate exponents on both sides of the equation and develop 3 equations with 3 unknowns. C equals 0, 1 plus a plus b minus 3c equals 0, and negative b equals 0. Solving the 3 equations gives us a equals negative 1, b equals 0, and c equals 0. Applying these exponents to the pi 2 group, pi 2 is h over w. We now create the final pi group, pi 3, which is equal to mu times w to the a, v to the b, rho to the c. We plug in the dimensions for all 4 variables, distribute the exponents through each term, and combine all the terms with base m, combine all the terms with base l, and combine all the terms with base t. The left side of the equation is mass raised to the power of 1 plus c, length raised to the power of negative 1 plus a plus b minus 3c, and time raised to the power of negative 1 minus b. We equate the exponents on both sides of the equation and come up with three equations and three unknowns. 1 plus c equals 0, negative 1 plus a plus b minus 3c equals 0, and negative 1 minus b equals 0. Solving the three equations gives us a equals negative 1, b equals negative 1, and c equals negative 1. Applying these exponents to the pi 3 expression, we have that pi 3 is mu over w v rho. Now that we've created our pi groups, we need to check that they are indeed dimensionless. We plug in the FLT dimensions for all variables in the pi groups, and we see that the dimensions all cancel out. Finally, we write out the relationship between the pi groups. Pi 1 is some function phi of pi 2 and pi 3. And plugging in the expressions for the pi groups, we have FD over W squared V squared rho equals some function phi of H over W and mu over rho VW. Although we could end the problem now, this is not the typical way to write the pi groups for an application involving drag. Instead, we'll use the reciprocal of the pi 2 and pi 3 groups. W over H is called the aspect ratio, and rho VW over mu is the Reynolds number. Additionally, the W squared term in the pi 1 group, which has dimensions of area, is usually replaced by the sine's profile area, W times H. In this form, pi 1 is called the drag coefficient. At this point, we would need to conduct experiments to find the functional relationship phi. This could be accomplished by varying the flow speed, which varies the Reynolds number, for sines with different aspect ratios, and measuring the resultant drag force required to keep the sine stationary.